This week on the show, we've got FreeBSD quarterly status reports to discuss, we've got OpenBSD changes to the installer, EC2 and IPv6, and much more. Stay tuned for your place to be, SD. BSD Now, episode 182, Bloaty McBloatface, recorded February 15th, 2017. Hey, I'm your host, Chris Moore.
And I'm Alan Jude.
And glad to have you with us this week. Yes. So yeah, that title, like, we're going to talk about something called Bloaty McBloatface later. Mm-hmm. And like, I read that and I was like, that's too good not to use as a title. So anyway, you have to stay tuned to find out what the heck we're talking about. That's called a tease. You see, we hook you in, then you have to, you know, wait and, you know, watch the whole episode to find out what happened. But anyway, it's going to be good stuff. We got an exciting episode coming your way and we're going to hop right into it because we got a lot of stuff to get to. So first up here, we have OpenBSD, some of the recent changes of note for 6.
Yes.
So you want to tell us a little bit about what they got going on here?
Yeah, so some of this I learned a little bit about at FOSDEM, but it's great to see Ted have a rundown here. First is that OpenBSD now, OpenBSD can now be cross-built using Clang.
Ooh, nice.
And they're working on that. They found that their LD.so, when built with the no built-ins option, or they have to start building it with the no built-in option because otherwise Clang would optimize the local versions of functions like dlmemset into a call to memset, which doesn't actually exist in that library. So that was a problem. They've modified their FTP client, which is actually also their HTTP client. So it's their equivalent to wget or fetch or whatever. So it now has a timeout that's shorter than the default of like 2 minutes. That in the installer, if you timeout to connect to a mirror, it can just try a different one without having to wait forever. So that's cool. They added complete HTTPS support in their installer, which I found very interesting. I wonder how they handle certificate verification in that. I'd like to look at that and steal from it, because I'd like to switch the FreeBSD installer to that as well. Because actually, while at FOSDEM, I switched the FreeBSD website to doing HTTPS downloads, but I haven't switched the installer yet.
Yeah, that would be nice.
One hint might be that they added a new utility called OCSP Check, or that's the online certificate status protocol, which is a way to check if a certificate's been revoked by calling the issuer directly.
Sure.
So they added a tool to be able to do that at the command line to verify a certificate against the OCSP responder. So I wonder,
one simple grep through a directory will probably tell you if that was the magic.
Yeah. I can understand how a tool like that would allow you to verify the certificate online, but how does that work if someone has a self-signed certificate where they do set up an OCSP server or something? Whereas we actually have to, you know, make sure we're talking to the real OpenBSD. So I need to dig into their stuff a little bit and figure out how they did it and see if that approach makes sense on FreeBSD.
Cool.
Because then they have the...
Coming soon to 12.0. This will be good.
Maybe 11.1 if I hurry up.
Ooh, okay. Get going on that, Alan. It'll be done by Tokyo.
You know, Ted is always humorous, so he's got netlock here, netlock there, netlock not quite everywhere. So they're working on, you know, Ungiant locking their network stack still. They have some other hilarious ones, like they removed the CVS tips section from the website. This forbidden knowledge is now forbidden. They got, for the networking stuff, they also got more per CPU counters in the network code, so that the advantage of doing one set of counters for each CPU is that when you have to lock the counter, you only have to lock it against other threads running on the same CPU instead of everybody. So it means that you can update the counter on all the other CPUs while you're locked on this one CPU. So it means there's a lot less contention. They actually disabled and locked out the silicon debug feature in some newer modern Intel CPUs.
Is that for security?
Yeah.
Or what?
So it's a feature to let you figure out what's going on the computer, but if it was used maliciously against you, it could be bad. They also added a mitigation for the wireless frame injection attack that was described at the Chaos Communication Conference in the talk titled Predicting and Abusing WPA2/802.11 Group Keys. So they have a mitigation against that, which seems interesting.
Okay.
They've also added support for multiple transmit if queues per network interface. So like on FreeBSD, where you can actually have 8 queues pointing to your NIC so that you can spread the load out across multiple CPUs. So they have something like that now for transmitting. And they support the BGE, which I think is Broadcom, BNX, I don't know which one that is, EM, which is the Gigabit Intels, MYX, which is I think the Milex or whatever, IX, which is the 10 gigabit Intel, HVN, which I think is Hyper-V virtualized.
Yeah, I don't know what that is.
And then XNF, which is Zen NetFront. So I think the HVN is the Hyper-V virtual NIC.
That makes sense.
But better network performance for all of those is a big deal. They also added a new feature to pledge their security API. So when a file, it tracks when a file is open and uses that to permit or deny ioctls against that file. So that you can control stuff like that. And they also re-implemented the byte range support in HTTPD because there was a memory denial of service attack possible with the old code. I wonder if that's related to the old one that Apache had where you could do a bunch of slightly overlapping ranges, a large number of small overlapping ranges and cause all kinds of headaches.
I don't know. But it sounds like they have not been been passive in the last couple of months.
No, well, they had a hackathon, so they got lots of work done. And they've
very nice.
Lots of other stuff they actually worked on in this. So if you pull up this page yourself, you can see lots of stuff, including they imported LLVM 3.9.1 and then LLVM 4.0.
All right. Okay.
And also an RFC for IPv6 atomic fragments. So there's new RFC that deprecates generating atomic fragments, so they remove the code in OpenBSD that can even possibly send those. And yeah, there's a huge page full of different options in here, so it's definitely worth checking out.
Even a new libDRM. Cool stuff. That's neat. Good job, OpenBSD guys. Okay, so next up, so that's kind of our OpenBSD status report. So now we're moving on. We got a FreeBSD status report for the end of 2016, the fourth quarter, an overview of all the work that happened during that period, which is October to December-ish. And it looks like, first of all, the ports team, they saw a lot of updates, and we have now surpassed 27,000 ports in the ports tree. That's a lot of ports. You guys are making it harder and harder for me to get full builds.
It was quite interesting because recently Warner managed to scan the proceedings of BSDCon 2000, which is an old Usenix conference about the BSDs that was held in the year 2000 in Monterey. And I was looking through basically the proceedings, like the book you get at Asia BSDCon. And one of them was actually Dan Langill talking about fresh ports, which had just been introduced. And it's like, when the ports tree started, there were like 150 ports. And as of today, there are like 4,000. It's like, wow.
Now we're at 4,000, you guys. I think my builder builds the first 4,000 in about 35 minutes. Anyway, let's see here. So next up, a core team update as well. They were busy as usual, of course. The foundation attended and sponsored a record 24 events in 2016.
Yeah.
Do we have a whole list of which events those were? I know like the BSD shows were obvious.
But they have a list on their blog post about it. But the ones they attended later in the year included, I think it's in here somewhere.
Right. Sorry, I put you on the spot.
Ohio Linux Fest, Grace Hopper, COSC, the Beria Vendor Summit and Dev Summit that we had at MeetBSD, Usenix Lisa, and the OSC in Beijing were the ones that they attended in the later part of the year.
But, so a nice variety of different conferences from little local Linux Fest to some of the bigger shows too. That's cool.
Yeah, they actually have a bigger list on their blog where they recapped all the stuff they did in 2016. So they did FOSDEM in January of 2016, the FreeBSD Storage Summit, Usenix Fast, Asia BSD Con, Flourish 2016, Linux Fest Northwest, OzCon, the Vendor and Developer Summit at BSD Can, the Usenix Annual Technical Conference, Texas Linux Fest, HOPE in New York, BSD CAM in Cambridge, Women Courage, SNIA, the Storage Conference, EuroBSDCon, the OpenZFS Developers Summit, Ohio Linux Fest, Grace Hopper, COSC, the MeetBSD stuff, Usenix OSDI, Usenix Lisa, and the OSE.
Hmm, okay. That's really cool.
Quite a bit
some of the other things. Oh, good.
Yeah, that was just quite a few conferences, and I think the plan for this year is even more.
Mm-hmm. So next up, it looks like some work was done on the Ceph file system, making that work on FreeBSD.
Mm-hmm. I know, which, it was mostly,
that's a distributed.
Yeah, so that was mostly just getting started when we talked about it in the last status report, but it's interesting. Mm-hmm. We got most of it working here.
So I guess my question is, do we have it in Porks? Does it use Fuse? Is this another Fuse one?
I don't think so. No, this is natively compiling it.
Hmm. Sorry,
so they have the instructions in here where you can check out the GitHub branch and just run the do FreeBSD script and it will build it. Mm-hmm. It's no longer necessary to manually patch some files in your FreeBSD tree to get it to work. The part they don't have yet is the kernel block device driver.
Okay.
They're still working on that. Although they're wondering if they might be able to just use ggatd to terminate that, since it's basically the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
A couple other things. But what's interesting here is, like you were mentioning before I accidentally cut you off, what Ceph is, if people don't know, is a distributed file system that can sit on top of another file system.
Yep.
So what that means is you could take, you know, four ZFS servers and create one virtual distributed file system that's actually backed by those. And mm-hmm. it will do things like make sure that any particular file or block or whatever exists on at least two or three of those ZFS servers. So even if a whole ZFS machine goes away, you can still access all your files.
Mm-hmm.
A feature I've been after cool. a little bit. It's like, sometimes I need more storage than you can physically fit in one machine.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is really cool. I know we've been looking at other block stores that are distributed as well. Mm-hmm. Like, there's some really neat things out there. So, yeah, this is cool.
I played
excited
with
to see them make some progress.
Getting Gluster to compile on FreeBSD like 2 years ago now, I think.
Yeah. Gluster scared us, though. We tried it a little bit internally here.
Yeah, it was
a little
fancy. Yeah.
Well, and even on Linux, like, we've seen it eat people's data. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah, I've heard better things about Ceph, but I think it was Ceph that munched SourceForge, although I think that was their fault.
Oh.
You remember the big SourceForge outage like a year and a bit ago or something like that? But I think that was their fault, not Ceph's fault.
Okay, that's fine.
But what'll be really nice is, now that it actually compiles on FreeBSD, it'd be great if maybe somebody that watches the show that maybe could even just set up a couple of FreeBSD VMs with ZFS and set up a Ceph on top of it and see how it works and where the sharp edges are. And, you know, I'd love to learn more about it. I just don't have time to experiment myself right now.
Right, yeah. People need to play with this. Give us some feedback. We'd like to hear.
So I'm sure the people doing all the work, I'm sure they're doing it because they want to use Ceph, but I'm sure they'd be much more excited about it if other people were to help as well. Mm-hmm. Although they also do have they've now got it set up with continuous integration so that changes to Ceph that happen upstream are tested against FreeBSD right away, which I think is an important step to the Ceph people, making sure they're not breaking FreeBSD by accident.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Very cool. Well, next up, we have OpenBSM. The FreeBSD audit framework has been updated and gotten some love the last quarter.
Yep. They have a new alpha release of that, and they would like to get some testing going on.
Mm-hmm. Egg Shouten has committed a front end to export sysctl data in a format usable by Prometheus, the open source monitoring system. Mm-hmm. Interesting. What kind of format is he using?
I forget exactly what the format looks like, but the important thing is it handles things like for the temperatures of your CPU, the sysctl is actually like dev.cpu.cpunumber.temperature. Whereas this can actually give you, reformats the data so you have temperature, which is an array of the temperatures of CPUs and so on.
Mm-hmm.
So it's sounds very useful. And it makes sense, even if you're using something other than Prometheus for your monitoring, to be able to extract this data in more of that kind of a format.
Okay, I'm looking. It looks like he structures it in a way that can be translated to Prometheus's metric format. I just don't know what that kind of intermediate step looks like. But still, that's cool. Getting it. I would like to see more things support, you know, JSON out of box would be kind of cool.
I actually
UCL, I know you're a fan.
I know that one of the developers from the PFSense project is working on making ARP, NDP, which is the IPv6 ARP, and a bunch of other utilities having to do with networking, be able to spit out JSON via Libzo, so that it's easier to do there, you know.
That would be nice. Yeah. I like it. Okay, so we also have lots of updates for various ARM boards. I know the Raspberry Pi 3 is shaped up nicely in the last multi-core, quarter as well.
Although I think the multi-core might have been in January, so it isn't in this report. But there's stuff for the Minnow board, like GPIO and I2C support. Various all-winter boards. Lots of stuff on ARM 64 for like the Pine 64 and the Raspberry Pi 3. And FreeBSD now boots on the Soft Iron Overdrive 3000, which is actual little desktop-y, server-y type machine that actually is ARM 64 for you. So that's cool.
Okay. Yep.
One of the other interesting was the reproducible builds project. So Ed Mast and Baptiste Drossan went to the World Reproducible Build Summit in Berlin in December. And with a couple of changes they committed, it is now possible to build a completely reproducible FreeBSD-based system, both the kernel and user land, although you have to set a couple of non-default settings.
Sorry, I got distracted looking at the wiki page for that because I was like, oh yeah, I need to go flip that on for TrueOS. I've been wanting to do that for a while. Yeah,
so just a couple of build flags you set and it basically fakes all the dates to a specific one and removes things like the SVN or git revision number from the uname string so that it's always the same and so on. With those couple of flags, someone can easily build exactly the bits that they find on the FreeBSD FTP mirrors in the future. So that they can know that what they're getting is exactly right. And the ports tree, they got about 80% of the ports tree is now reproducible.
Hey, that's a huge chunk out of 27,000. Yeah. That's really
with
good.
With that, we hope to see smaller package updates in the future and just more being able to say that, hey, the package I just fetched from the internet, I could build that myself and prove that it's exactly what is available from the source code.
Yeah, that's really nice. So I need to go look at that. There's so many things, not enough time to look at, but we need to pull that in. That is good stuff.
So if you're interested in that at all, they're looking for help investigating sources of non-reproducibility in individual ports, which 20% of 27,000 is a lot of ports to look at. Although some of those I think are complete classes of thing, whereas once they figure out what the problem is, they can fix it and apply that fix to thousands of ports.
That makes sense. Okay, we also have lots of tool chain updates. So GCC's gotten an update, LLD, GDB, etc. So we've had a few things get updated there. And, of course, various updates from the major port teams as well, discussing where they're at with things. I know, there was a section on the DRM stuff as well.
Yep.
It was put in
here. LXQT, Mono, Wine got a bunch of updates, XFCE, etc.
Cool. Yeah, that's really neat. Okay, well, guys, go check that out when you get a chance. There's a lot more on there than we were able to cover here in this short time.
And there's usually links to things they need help with if you're interested in getting involved, and lists of people to contact if you have questions, and so on.
Okay, so really quick before we continue on in the news here, we need to hit our first sponsor this week, which is going to be IX Systems. Website for that, ixsystems.com/BSDnow. That's where you go and get in touch with one of their sales engineers who can help design the next server or system or fleet of systems, whatever it is you're looking for. They can custom build that for you. So, of course, obviously, all based on the latest and greatest Intel processors. So if you need a specific model or revision, let them know that. But also the cool thing about IX and what really makes IX unique is when you call and talk to them, get really specific about what you're going to do. So if you're running a database, tell them that. Heck, tell them which database. Heck, tell them which, what record size you're going to use. How many things are you storing in the database? You know, they can help figure these things out with you, right? What kind of ZFS is going to work best for that? Or, what block sizes? No, these class of disks might even work better. So just lots of little things. The more detail you can give these folks, the better. So they can make sure they design a system that performs exactly to the specs you're looking for.
Yeah, it takes a lot of the work away from you. You know, if you're buying from a regular hardware vendor, you have to decide what type of disks you want to buy. Whereas at IX, they have the experience, depending on your database, maybe even though you need some storage, it'd be better to buy more smaller disks in order to have more spindles working at once than it would be to actually buy a smaller number of larger disks.
Mm-hmm.
Or,
well, They provide the answers to those questions, all right? A lot of times, I mean, do you have the time to go do all the research on that? And do you really know the entire range of hardware out there? I mean, this is what they do. So if you call them up and say, this is what I want to do, they can say, okay, we know these discs work best for that particular use case.
And I need at least this many IOPS. It's like, okay, well, if you need that many IOPS and this much storage, you're better off with twice as many 1 terabyte discs than half as many 2 terabyte discs. Maybe what you want to do is consider something that's all flash. So that's the other thing they've just announced is they have a new all-flash device that's up to, I think it's 30 terabytes, it says?
I believe so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but they have all-flash arrays that you can get for under $10,000, which, you know, that sounds like maybe that's a bit of money, but for all-flash compared to what you get elsewhere, that's a lot cheaper.
That's pretty amazing. Yeah. That's a good deal. So you definitely want to get in touch with the folks over at IX. And when you talk to them, tell them you heard about it here on BSD Now. That clues them in that, hey, you know, this person we're talking to here is a little bit smarter than your typical, you know, individual. And we can talk some shop, right?
Figure out exactly what they're doing. 10 terabytes of all flash for under $10,000, which, you know, just buying regular desktop SSDs, prices under $1 a gig are actually not that easy to find. So. For enterprise grade flash and a complete system, it's got you know, an E5-2637V4, so that's quad core 3.5 gigahertz and 128 gigs of RAM. So, you know, it's really gonna blast with you know, 300,000 IOPS on a 16K block size. See, if you were looking at some other vendor, they would have had some flashy number of IOPS and not mentioned the block size.
Yeah. As I said, they know their stuff. So definitely check into IX next time you're going to be purchasing some equipment. Give them a shout and let them work out what will work best in your new situation. Okay, so we got a couple more stories to hit here. So we got Amazon rolls out IPv6 support on EC2. Mm-hmm. So this was – it's written here a few hours ago that Amazon had announced they rolled out. Was that there, Jugo?
So yeah, a few hours ago Amazon deployed their IPv6 support on EC2 to 15 different regions, basically all the Amazon regions except for Beijing. So Colin says, this seems to be a good time to write about actually using that on FreeBSD. The good news, all future releases of FreeBSD will support IPv6 on EC2 out of the box. He says, I committed changes to head last week and merged them to the stable 11 branch just moments ago. To have FreeBSD automatically use the IPv6 addresses EC2 makes available automatically.
Nice.
So next is the slightly annoying news. In order to get IPv6 support on the existing EC2 images, which is your 10.3 and your 11.0, you'll need to run a few simple commands, although they're really not that bad. He says, I consider this unfortunate but inevitable. While Amazon has been unusually helpful recently, there's nothing they could do to get their support for IPv6 networking configured into FreeBSD released more than a year ago. So basically, all you have to do is package install dual-dh client, which is a version of dh client that will get an IPv4 and IPv6 address.
Nice.
Then you just set your ifconfig underscore default, which finds the first NIC, even no matter what it's named, which is helpful because depending on your Amazon instance type, you might have a virtualized NIC or a PCI pass-through type NIC.
Sure.
And you basically do you know, synchronous DHCP and also accept router advertisements. And then just add two more lines to rc.conf, which is, you know, IPv6 activate all interfaces, and change the DH client program from the default DH client to your new use local sbin dual DH client. And he also provides a way to do this with the config init stuff. So if you're actually spinning up new Amazon instances, you can just paste these five lines into the console or provide them via the API, and the image will do it all automatically.
Nice.
He says, third is the bad news, which is to actually enable IPv6 on EC2 is a ridiculous seven-step process. But he walks you through actually using the Amazon Management Console to do all the things to actually set up your IPv6, set it up so that your Amazon will actually give an IPv6 IP address to your instances. He says, finally, one important caveat. While EC2 is clearly the most important piece of having, or sorry, EC2 is the most important piece of having IPv6, there are, you know, some other services that don't have it yet. He says, of particular concern to me, the application load balancer support for IPv6 is still missing in many regions, and the elastic load balancer in the VPC stuff doesn't support IPv6 at all, which matters to people who run non-HTTP services. Make sure that your IPv6 support has been rolled out to all of the services you need before you can start migrating to it.
For sure. That would suck to get halfway through and run my network.
Oh, it's like everything. Well, we're all set up with V6, but the load balancer doesn't do it, so nobody's going to use the V6.
Yeah, that would be annoying.
What I found especially interesting here is if it's good to see FreeBSD being ready to use this feature on day zero, and without Colin doing all the work he's been doing on EC2, I don't think that would have been the case.
Yeah, this is really cool. Okay, so next up we have George Neville Neal, who we've interviewed, a couple times now on this show? Over the years, definitely. He tries valiantly for over an hour to convince a Linux fan of the error of their ways. And we have a link to the YouTube video here.
Yeah. And not just any Linux person either.
No. Give us the description, Alan.
Oh, this is Brian Lunduk, who is used to do the Linux Action Show podcast on this network and now has his own different podcast. But he's on the community board something for OpenSUSE and works for SUSE the company. They talked about many different topics, including licensing, but not just, arguing GPL versus BSD, but the motivations behind it and how it affects vendors and so on. Just vendor relations in general between the projects, the differences in the community, the differences in development model, interesting things about drivers and hardware support and how that situation's got both better and worse over the years. And George also talked about his work on his FreeBSD Foundation. He's wearing the foundation shirt there. And also a bit about the book, the design and implementation of the FreeBSD operating system, second edition, and so on.
Oh, that sounds like an exciting shootout. You may have to go check that out. But wait until our show's done first. Don't switch us off yet.
Yes, don't switch us off. But if you need more content, George is always informative and entertaining to listen to.
Yeah, definitely. I would check that out. And who knows? Maybe some of those little seeds he planted will take root and we'll have another FreeBSD convert down the road. Or maybe I shouldn't get my hopes up.
Yeah. We're sorry for directing you to a Linux podcast. You can skip it if you want, but it's worth listening to George.
Okay, we're heading into the news roundup now, so we'll go ahead and rapid fire a few of these at you. But first up, we have a link over to GitHub of an interactive script that makes it easy to install 50 plus desktop environments following a base install of FreeBSD 11, which, that'll be really helpful. I can see a lot of people finding that very useful. So go ahead and tell us about that a little bit, Alan.
Yeah, so basically, it's a shell script that lets you pick from any of these different desktop environments, and it will install them for you. It's kind of a nice nod to FreeBSD that if you look at the actual script for some of these, they're like three or four lines. Right?
Package install foo. Yeah,
package install minus y fluxbox, add the exec start fluxbox to /root/.x session, and then run XDM.
I'm looking.
Yeah, KDE one. I did a pull request against the KDE one today because of the way they were editing rc.conf. I was like, you obviously have not heard of sysrc.
Oh, yeah, they're not using sysrc. Oops.
Yeah, so I have a pull request to replace 4 lines of code with one that just sets KDEM4_enable=yes.
On an unrelated note, is there a way in sysrc that you know of to append to the values that are in a variable?
I think that was added. Because, people had that need. Although you could just do a get and do the append and, right, there's a flag to get the value easily, but.
I did it in a shell script for some other project where it's like I got it and then I went through the list and removed the value I wanted and then appended the ones.
The other one is you would want to be able to remove one value from a list.
Yeah. Yeah, because like for some programs have an arguments you can pass, so you'll do -p for the port number and then something else and something else. Anyway,
well, that one gets more complicated. I was thinking more like when you have a list of things like static routes and you just list like A, B, or cloned interfaces, right? Where you just list like four of them, being able to add and remove to that is loaded. It makes sense. And being able to add for arguments makes sense, but for remove for arguments might be slightly more complicated.
Sure.
Although you could remove, you know, minus P, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway. Yeah.
We made it work.
Yes. This is a cool script. I'm going to have to look at it some more. In the past, I had actually written a patch for the FreeBSD installer to add a menu to the end of the installer to choose to install like KDE GNOME or XFCE. I'll have to revise that and add Lumina to the list. But I was having trouble getting the actual login managers configured correctly. So I might be able to steal a little bit from this guy's scripts here and have that ready to go.
Okay.
Although really looking at the installer now, we've added a couple too many menus. It's a lot more steps than it was back in that, like 10.2.
Need to do a little pruning.
Well, you know, it makes sense to set the date and time, but you know, generally just enter. It's not that hard. But
okay, cool. Mm-hmm. Let's move on to the next story here. So we have Firefox 51. Okay, yeah, that doesn't sound all that exciting, right? Until we tell you it's on a Spark 64. And then you're like, what? Yes.
The title is, we did not hit the wall yet.
Okay, so tell us who did it. Obviously, it's NetBSD folks.
So this is posted by Martin Hussman, a NetBSD developer, and he's telling the story of trying to get Firefox 51 running on his Spark 64 machine. So he says, I'm using a Spark 64 Sunblade 2500 Silver as a desktop machine. The fact that it says Blade in the name makes it sound like it's not the right form factor for a desktop machine. But anyway.
One would assume, but yeah.
For my pretty light desktop needs, you know, besides the usual developer tools like editors, compilers, Subversion, Git, etc., and admin stuff, text-based, he uses MPG123 and mServe for his music cues, GIMP for image editing, and of course Firefox as a browser. Recently, I updated all of my installed packages to package source-current, and as usual, the new Firefox version failed to build. Fortunately, the issues were minor. As they've all been handled upstream in Firefox 52 already, I just needed to backport a few of those fixes. This made the package build, but after a few minutes of test browsing, it crashed. Not surprisingly, this was reproducible. Any website that tried to play audio would trigger the crash. Mm-hmm. A bit surprising, though, the same happened on AMD 64 machines. That was actually a relatively big bug. After a bit of digging, the bug was easy to fix, and Upstream already took the fix and committed it to their libqb repository.
Sure.
So he says, success! I'm now happily editing this post using Firefox 51 on my Blade 2500. He says, I saw one crash in 2 days of browsing, and unfortunately couldn't yet reproduce it. He's now got GDB attached to his Firefox in case it misbehaves again.
Sure.
But the reason for the title of his post, of that, you know, Firefox hasn't hit the wall yet, is that you may have read elsewhere that Firefox will start to require a working Rust compiler to build. This is a bit unfortunate, as Rust, while academically interesting, is right now not a very good implementation language if you care about portability. The only available compiler requires a working LLVM backend, which we still are debugging. This is our auto builds produce Spark sets with LLVM, but the result is not fully working due to what we believe to be a code generation bug in LLVM. It seems we need to fix this soon, which will be good anyway, independent of the rush issue, but besides the backend, only very recent traces of Spark 64 support popped up in Rust. However,
somebody was doing it.
He says, however, we still have a few Firefox versions in order to get this going, so he's still optimistic. Even once that happens, I suppose they could switch to the long-term support branch and try to ride that one out until Rust for Spark 64 is a thing.
Oh, no. I want to see Firefox 60 on a Spark 64 with full Rust.
Another upcoming change is that Kero, which currently used for 2D graphics backend, at least on Spark 64, will be phased out, and Skya will be the only supported software rendering target. I've never even heard of the new one.
I have. It's the first I've heard of that, too. Okay.
Of course, I've only ever heard of Kero as that damn thing that gets installed on my headless box that is like, do I really need that? Although usually I was, doing 2D graphics, like generating images in a website or whatever, so it makes sense. But it says, unfortunately, Skya does, as of now, not support any big indie machines at all. So I guess that's even forsaking some ARM machines. I'm looking for help getting Skya to work on big indie hardware in general and Spark 64 in particular. So, yes, it seems like a lot of change going on in the world where people are not necessarily caring about other hardware platforms. And I can sympathize with people not caring about Spark 64, but, you know.
Not having ARM, exactly. Though? That's a little, like, not a good idea.
And he also looked at a couple alternative browsers in case Firefox becomes not an option. He looked at NetSurf. Mm-hmm. He says it's nice and small, has a few tweaks and so on, but doesn't actually support JavaScript well enough to run most websites. So, obviously, that's a problem.
Sure.
Midori, they call it lightweight, but it's based on WebKit, which alone is a few times more heavy than all of Firefox. It crashes immediately on startup on Spark 64. He's currently investigating it, but it's low priority. And he's actually had to replace a hard drive in the machine to make enough room for the debug objects for WebKit, which are over 20 gigabytes.
Mm-hmm.
It's funny to think that somebody's using a machine with a hard drive that's less than 20 gigabytes.
We had a ticket come in on the FreeNAS bug tracker not too long ago where somebody was trying to use 2 gigabyte disks in their NAS, and they showed up as 1.9 gigabyte, and we have a hard limit of 2 gig minimum. I was kind of like, I don't even want to know. Like, just
go buy a couple of $4 USB sticks, and they'll be 4 gigs apiece.
Right? Get yourself a 4 gigabyte disk. Anyway. We should move on. Okay, so next up, our next sponsor this week is going to be DigitalOcean, and the website for that is digitalocean.com. You'll want to go there, get signed up. You can immediately start creating droplets. Now, little trick though, when you get signed up, you want to use the coupon code FREEBSDNOW. And that's all one word, all lowercase, FREEBSDNOW, no spaces, right? So you go ahead and pop that in there, and that'll give you a $10 credit, which is good for running, VMs for 2 months straight. If you want to pay by the hour, you could do that and make it stretch out. Maybe you have you're a weekend warrior and you're doing a little project here and there where you want to spin up a VM. Totally doable. And the cool thing about DigitalOcean is they have a full API setup that's going to make it super easy for you remotely to reach in and spin up these VMs, tear them down, set them up, pretty much do everything you want. Locations all around the world as well. So if you want to find a data center close to you, they got a handy little tool up on their website, which will let you test the pings and connectivity between your location and all their various data centers around the world. And of course, some great locations like New York and Singapore, was it London? Yep. It's been a while since we've gone through the list of them. So I think India was one of the last ones they added.
Remembering it correctly, it's San Francisco, Toronto, New York, London, Amsterdam, Germany, Bangalore, Singapore.
Yeah, that sounds about right. I still want one in Atlanta, guys. Come on, that's right down there. Like the biggest data center in the world that is down there, supposedly. So let's make that happen.
The biggest one was in Utah, anyway.
Oh, is it
well,
in Utah?
Well, that's the NSA one. You can't actually put your own stuff in there.
Oh, well. Yes. So the biggest public one. Anyway,
the new feature they just rolled out is load balancers. So starting at 3 cents per hour or $20 a month, you can get their automatic load balancer, which will distribute traffic, incoming traffic across all your droplets, enabling you to build more reliable and performant applications by creating this redundancy. The load balancers are available in all data center regions and have no additional bandwidth charges. So unlike some other load balancers where you'd be charged for the traffic between the load balancer and the back end or something, or where the load balancer would cost more per bandwidth, this one does not.
Mm-hmm. Very nice. Very nice. So yeah, check it out today. When you use that coupon code, you're also telling them you heard about it here on BSD Now. So that's good for us. It's good for you. Everybody's happy. Go start spinning up your droplets right now. Okay, our next story, introducing Bloaty McBloatface, a size profiler for binary. So yes, for those of you who've been with us since the start, that was the title for this week's episode. So now Alan is going to tell us what exactly that all means, because when I first read this, I was like, say what?
But anyway, the author says, I'm very excited to announce that today I'm open sourcing a tool I've been working on for several months at Google. It's called Bloaty McBloatface. And it lets you explore what's taking up space in your .o, .a, and .so and executable binary files. So when you're building code, whether it's as a library or as a executable or whatever, you can now figure out what's taking up all the space. So you can see here, he ran it against itself. And you can see that 38% of this size is this debug info blob. and then the code locations and the strings and so on. And that the actual text is only taking up 4.2% of the file size, but takes up 72% of the VM size. Because the debug information takes space on disk, but doesn't actually take space in memory when the program's running. Mm-hmm. And you see that when it's running, the program takes 456 kilobytes of memory, but on disk, it's 7.75 megabytes, most of that being the debug data. Another interesting one is that you can break it down by compile unit slash source file. So you can actually figure out which file of source code is taking up all the space rather than just individual symbol names, which can help you track things down. He says it's available under an Apache 2 license. All the code is available on GitHub. It's quick and easy to build, though it does require a somewhat recent compiler because it uses C++ 11. Bloaty primarily supports ELF files, which would be BSD and Linux binaries, but there's also some support for MachO files from OS X. He's interested in expanding Bloaty's capabilities to more platforms if there is interest.
Yeah, interesting.
He says we've been using the Bloaty tool a lot on the protocol buffers team at Google to evaluate the binary size impact of our changes. If a change causes a size increase, where did that come from? What sections or symbols grew and why and so on? So there's actually a diffing mode built into it. So you can actually diff an old version of the binary with the new version and see, oh, the debug symbols take the same amount of memory but have grown slightly in file size. But you see the text has taken, you know, 1.8% more memory now and so on.
That's really interesting.
And it actually shows which symbols have shrunk as well. It says Bloaty gives a high-level overview by sections by default, but command line switches can help you dig into details by slicing and dicing different segments, you know, looking at segments, sections, symbols, compile units, and even inline functions. You can use these slicing and dicing capabilities even if the overall binary size isn't your primary concern. One thing I like doing with Bloaty is seeing what section my variables end up in. If you have a global variable, it shows up in .data. But you know it doesn't actually need to be writable. Slap a const on the variable and watch it move to the read-only data segment. And a bunch of things like that. Yeah, I'm kind of interested in using this to figure out where maybe some of the fat that could be trimmed is in the boot code.
Yeah, I mean, every kilobyte you save there is a win.
Especially looking at the memory resident size because, you know, we actually have that hard cap at like 500 and something kilobytes. So, you know, making sure we don't have any redundancy in there or anything that doesn't need to be there would be quite useful.
Yeah, that's really cool. And with a name like that, you'll never forget. Never forget it. So that's good.
Anyway, check out the page.
Yeah, and you had to know here too.
Let us know how it goes.
This could be integrated with Jenkins or something too.
Yeah, really that was the other thing is
tell you like if something changes all of a sudden, oh, your binary just increased in size majorly in one aspect or another.
It's like, cool. Especially if there was no code change and the binary suddenly gets bigger, then, oh, maybe we need to look at the tool chain. Or if it's like, you made this one small change, but it exploded the size of the binary. Are you sure that's what you meant to do? I think that kind of stuff would be very useful. You know, I know we've had to start trimming down what goes on the disk one ISO for FreeBSD because when we included Clang with the binary that's like 40 megabytes, it eventually wouldn't fit on a CD anymore.
And we've been fighting that for years. Trust, we didn't fit on a CD for a long time. Then we shrunk back down and it's been a challenge. Okay, so next up, a BSD-licensed MDNS responder. So, of course, one of the things we just have to deal with in the modern world is service and system discovery. Many of us have fiddled with Avahi or MDNSD, you know, various other MDNS services across the years. So for various reasons, a lot of those haven't been a best fit on BSD systems. So today we have a GitHub project to point you at, which is a little bit older, but it's been recently forked and updated and added pledge support for OpenBSD, which is kind of cool. So first of all, they mention in the README here, why do we need an alternative to some of the more popular options out there? They list their reasons. They said this is an attempt to bring native MDNS and DNSSD to OpenBSD, mainly because all the other options suck and proper network browsing is a nice feature these days. So of course they ask, well, why not Apple's MDNSD? Number one, it sucks big time. Number two, no BSD license. Number three, overcomplex API. Number four, it's not really OpenBSD-like. And then you say, well, what about Avahi? That's what everyone else uses. So, of course, they mentioned it's not BSD licensed. It's GPL. Has also an overcomplex API. It's not OpenBSD-like. And the biggest one for me, and the reason we didn't like in a TrueOS, was it has a lot of dependencies. Dbus and other stuff just kind of comes with it. And it's like, all I want to do is, you know, scan the network for services, right? I don't need all that. Anyway, those all sound like a lot of pretty compelling reasons. And what makes this new information, again, of course, is the pledge support. So maybe it's time for some more BSDs to start taking a little closer look at this, considering
I'm wondering about this. Doesn't DigitalOcean use MDNS to provide the IP addresses to the droplets?
I think they do, or I think to discover them.
Right? And so that means that one of the things they have to do is that you know, when you get a default FreeBSD image from DigitalOcean, it has Avahi installed in order to do that.
If
we could have something like this that was built into base, it would mean, you know, you could eliminate all those dependencies and packages that you might not necessarily want to have in your droplet.
That's exactly the reason I wanted to mention this story and highlight it, not just for FreeBSD, but for all the BSDs, right? It might be time to consider having something like this in the base just to make the whole cloud spinning up of VMs and whatnot a lot easier in the future where you can discover them.
One I was thinking about was being able to plug in a headless FreeNAS and then find it on your network.
Yep. We've already done some work to make that happen. But again, this is a cleaner solution, I think. I'd like to explore this. So I would love to see the FreeBSD installer have an option or a flag somewhere where it just turns this on by default, right? And then you can scan your network from your laptop and go, oh, there's my system I just installed or my VM. Done. Right? That just seems to make a lot of sense to me anyway. So hopefully it'll get some traction now. Now with the new pledge support, I wonder if that's a prelude to it landing in OpenBSD proper. So. But anyway. Yeah, I think so too. So we'll keep an eye on that and see what happens. But hopefully we'll see more BSDs adopt that as well. Okay, so we got some beastie bits to get to, and we will throw these out at you here really quick. And then we got some questions and feedback from you in the audience as well. So let's start with our first beastie bit. So we have a YouTube video of Ben O'Rice over at the linux.conf.au. The trouble with FreeBSD is the titling of this particular talk.
So he saw a talk at linux.conf.au last year about, I think, community management in the Python project and talking about some of the things. And he decided to explain why some of those don't necessarily scale to a project the size of FreeBSD or to a project the age of FreeBSD, but also, you know, so basically he talks about some of the problems we've had and how we're dealing with them and trying to get more ideas on how to do better.
Yep.
But it's an interesting talk, so I recommend checking it out.
Very good. Very good. So we also have next here the state of the port of VMS to x86. Looks like a PDF of that.
So some crazy people, actually the crazy people at VMS Software, are trying to port VMS, the old original VAX software, to 64-bit x86. So you could run it on your computer.
Because I don't know. Firefox on Spark or VMS on x86? Okay. Anyway.
Yeah.
We got to have an award we give out sometimes.
Yes. For the biggest waste
just
of
because
time.
I could award. Anyway, if you're interested in that, take a look at their PDF. Next we have is Microsoft Azure now offers patent troll protection. Okay, interesting. How do they do that?
So basically, it's a service you subscribe to as part of your Azure thing, and you get access to their pool of 10,000 legal patents to protect you, I guess.
As long as you're an Azure customer.
But, you know, if you want to run FreeBSD
for legal protection
in Azure, you can get protection against a whole host of different patents because Microsoft's already paid for the license for them so that they can't get sued about them.
Interesting. Okay. I wonder. Yeah, that's an interesting model. Okay. Very cool. And then last two things we got to make sure we draw your attention to. The FreeBSD Storage Summit. We have a link here on the foundation page. That's happening,
February 27th
of this month?
In Santa Clara, California. It's actually at the USENIX FAST, which is the File Systems and Storage Technologies Conference. Mm-hmm. So on that Monday, if you happen to be in the Bay Area or Silicon Valley, or I don't know what it's called, that part of California.
any place that's drivable to that part of the world.
You should definitely check it out. You can.
Yeah. Alan and myself will be there.
And lots of other people I know will be there. So
definitely
we'll be talking about all things storage. So,
okay. And then the next thing, if you're going to be in Tokyo for Asia BSD Con, for example, make sure you come to Beehive Con.
Yep.
I think Michael Dexter's in the process of getting that spun up again. They've done that in the past couple years.
So that'll be Thursday, March 9th, between 6:30 and 9:30.
Okay.
So we conveniently this year schedule it so it happens after the tutorials are over if you're taking a tutorial. Last year I took George Neville Neal's D-Trace tutorial and it ended up getting rescheduled because George had another commitment and it ended up being over top of BeehiveCon. So while I donated dinner for everyone at BeehiveCon, I didn't get to have
any. You didn't. Poor Alan didn't get any dinner. Those bento boxes were nice.
but I actually went with some of the people from my class, the D-Trace class, and we had a nice dinner.
So you got better.
We got something we bought dinner from a vending machine up the street.
Oh, well, okay. Hey, that's actually still pretty good.
you get a ticket out of the vending machine, and then you go sit down at a restaurant, and they bring you food. So.
Oh, so you tried to make it sound all casual. It was at a vending machine, but no.
It's a very small restaurant, but just like the first one we saw walking.
Every restaurant is small.
Yes, but it was like the first restaurant we saw on the hill towards the train station from the venue. True. It was very good, though.
For you can have a lot of fun with us next year or this year.
If you're going to be at BeehiveCon, do submit a talk. They're looking for more speakers. Even if it's just, I use Beehive to do this, or I use OpenBSD VMM to do this, that'd be great. Mm-hmm. Or we'd love to hear more people that are using Zen on FreeBSD even. It's called BeehiveCon, but it's the BSD Hypervisor Conference. Any of the hypervisors on any of the BSDs, whether it's Beehive or Zen on FreeBSD, VMM on OpenBSD, Zen on NetBSD, VirtualBox, QMU, whatever. We want to hear about it.
That's what we need is a VirtualBox talk. Yeah. There we go. I run that all the time. Anyway, okay. Well, if you're going to be out there, be sure to come out. Alan and myself should be there as well. Okay, so before we hit your feedback and questions, our last sponsor this week is going to be Tarsnap, the website for that, tarsnap.com/BSDnow, where you want to go get signed up and start doing your backups the proper way, the right way, the encrypted way, and the truly paranoid way all in one. How cool is that? So, of course, Tarsnap makes it super simple. They have clients for just about every OS under the sun. So, yes, you can do it on Linux or, heck, even Windows if you want. Your OS X, no problem. But if you're running a system where you want to compile it yourself, what's really cool about Tarsnap and where you don't see other backup vendors even try to compete is they release the source code. So you can go grab the code off their website, compile it yourself, and run your own binary. So we put the truly paranoid in here. But definitely very cool, and you can audit it to make sure it does exactly what it claims, which is backups are done securely and encrypted on your system before they go out over the wire. So you don't have to worry about anything on the remote end at the data center or an employee or rogue employee of either Collins or Amazon or whoever's hosting the data. You don't have to worry about somebody getting in and finding your data. So definitely good stuff. Check out Tarsnap today. Don't forget to back up that encryption key, though. You lose that, you're done. And that's kind of the whole purpose of it.
Like it says here in the FAQ, even if an attacker breaks into Tarsnap storage, if they don't have your private key, they can't use or modify the data.
That's right. So definitely check it out today. Super cheap, really easy to get started. I know me and Alan have been using it for years now, so hopefully you will enjoy it as much as we have. It's not much to do, really. You just kind of set it up, throw it in your cron job, and you're done. Then you get, in my case, I get a nice email every night telling me how much new data was backed up, and that's how I monitor. So,
If we learned anything from that GitLab thing recently, it's that you should try doing a restore and make sure that you still have the key in place and everything.
That's right. It's a little important. Okay, so let's get to feedback here. So first up is Farhan, who writes in, says, "Hi, I'm looking to purchase a 15-inch laptop for FreeBSD. The problem is the selection of laptops from the wiki is extremely limited." I think that might be a little old, too. And he says, "Given that I will be largely using it for programming or YouTube and similar tasks, I have no need for the latest and greatest i7000 chip. In fact, I would prefer a used laptop to cut down on e-waste. This might be a good area for the FreeBSD project to work on, as the current list of reviewed laptops is exceedingly light." Well, I mean, there's older ones on there. If you're looking for a used one, go grab an old Lenovo.
Yeah, X220s on eBay are around the $200 US mark. I have two of them here. Yep. They're great science machines. I think,
They're fantastic little boxes.
They're not 15, are they?
What size is next? I don't remember what those are.
I think this is 13
inch. I think my 520 was a 15 inch. My T520.
Is 520 15 or 17 inch? 15, I think.
I don't know.
Yeah,
I think
it was so 15. The 220 is 12.9 inches or something. The 420 is 14 inches and the 520 is 15 inches, I think that works. But yeah, anything in the for the size you want, you're probably looking at the T520, 530, 540, etc. I have my T530 and I love it. It works great. Suspend and resume even works. The Wi-Fi works. Everything is great. I got very lucky when I bought that.
Hey, speaking of suspend and resume, X1 Carbons now suspend and resume properly on TrueOS.
Nice. That's a big deal.
The Skylake ones. So Matt Macy accepted, I think, a patch somebody sent in, a pull request that fixes the DRM. So we have full 3D acceleration and suspend resume works with the lid even. Like, so you can close it, it suspends, you open it up, it resumes, video comes back, Wi-Fi comes back, everything works. So
hotness.
That is a very hotness. But that just happened last week. News? You know what? We should have blogged about that on the TrueOS project. So we mentioned it in passing, I think, on a forum post or blog post, but that's now a thing. Yeah, so grab an X1 Carbon deal with Skylake. That's a very big deal. So you'll need to grab either Matt Macy's latest work out of his DRM Next branch, or grab the latest TrueOS that we pushed last week, midweek-ish. And that's so just kind of
February 5th one, so I'll have to go one more.
Yeah, we're actually about to roll a new ISO for this week, so if you want to wait and grab that one. By default, we still set the mode setting driver on, and we don't turn on acceleration because we're kind of having people try it to make sure it works in all cases before we just enable it across the board. But if you make one small tweak to your xorg.conf and just turn off the software rendering, and if it, you know, if it works for you, great, then you're good to go. But we've been running it on a few different Skylake laptops here, and like they're all suspending and resuming again. It's really nice. So anyway. There's an option. I know that's not used and doesn't really help you, Farron, but for anybody else who's looking for a laptop out there, that's the hot tip right now.
Yeah, for 15-inch, you're definitely probably looking at the Lenovo T5X0, where the X is 20 is Sandy Bridge, 30 is Ivy Bridge, et cetera, 60 is Skylake. I love my T530, but you can probably get a T520 a bit cheaper. It's all good stuff.
It's very good stuff. Okay, so let's move on next here. So it was Hajalti writes in. He said, thanks for the feedback in the last BSD Now show. Enjoy the silence. He said, good job on pronouncing my name. Hey, we try, but you know, most of the time we get it wrong. So we're glad we got one right this time. He said, I've had an English-speaking name. People give up calling me Hajalti and just use Jason instead. I suppose that works. And he goes on a little bit about the background of his name. But I want to get to his question here. He said, I've managed to set up Rclone in a jail. It looks like this is on a FreeNAS box. He said, now I need to figure out how to set up a cron job in the jail, which runs Rclone and dumps the backup files to Google Drive. Hopefully I will find a good solution. Well, I just wanted to highlight this, not so much to tell you how to do it, but just to encourage you. This is actually not that hard. So just Google how to set up a cron job.
Doing it in the jail is exactly the same as doing it in the host, except for you do it in the jail.
Exactly. So you log into the jail. I would personally just put Rclone in a shell script so you can do some redirection of like the output to a log file and stuff. So it's doesn't easier to,
Or to nowhere because it's in the jail by default.
But it seems like a one or two line shell script would work. So in my case, a lot of times I'll even set a Sentinel file. So if it's running, say there's a really big backup that takes all night and it's still running, it'll stop kicking off the next one until the
first one. Because you don't want to find four of them running concurrently one day.
Yeah, that would suck.
Why is my internet slow?
Anyway, right? But it's totally doable, and we encourage you to set it up. Etsy crontab inside the jail is going to work just like Etsy crontab outside of the jail, and hopefully you'll be in good shape. Hopefully you've already solved it by now, but this should be very doable. Okay, so speaking of jails, next up is Ivan. He says, hello, Alan and Chris. For the last week or two, I've been intensely playing with FreeBSD on my servers and decided to switch the majority of them from CentOS to FreeBSD. Yay, another one. We need to have like a little bell that rings or something every time we hear that, right? or maybe a little animation. Get on that, somebody from Jupyter. Anyway, instead, in the process, I've decided to use FreeBSD Jails as it will provide me with more dense environment and spare me some bucks on monthly bills for the servers. As I currently have a few digital machines at DigitalOcean, I've decided to cut them down to one big dedicated box. He said, which may later become one big DigitalOcean VPS, but he's like, that's not relevant for now. He said, anyhow, I've started playing with FreeBSD Jails for management. I've been using the Easy Jail utility, which at one point was reviewed on the show, but I've found it to lack some of the features I'm finding myself to need. At least I'm not familiar how to use it to its full potential.
I still use it, maybe I can help. So let's see.
All right, he says, I basically need to be able to create a base machine template and then use that to deploy new jails. It would be nice if additional programs within that jail could be managed with the package utility. He said, binary updates all the way. He said, I've heard about IOCage and read some tutorials on Dan's site, but when looking at it further, it seems it isn't maintained actively anymore. Instead, there's another fork called IOCell. Should I consider switching to that? Well, first of all, just as an
email might be
that.
2 days older than that news.
Yeah, because that news came out. The new IOCage is out. It's written in Python. It's super fast. It's very much like the old one. So command line usage is almost identical. But anyway, I would encourage using that.
IOCage is still actively maintained. It was just going through a rewrite, but that's done now. So there's that. And then there's IOCell is a fork of the old shell-based one if you want to keep that for whatever reason.
Sure. He said, basically, I want to ask is, what do you use for managing jails? How are you automating and templating those jails? Could you go a bit further into explaining your practices for managing FreeBSD jails and provide neat tips and tricks as you usually do?
Yeah. So with EasyJail, there are templates and flavors, but I've never really used them. I use Puppet for ours. So we a job on the host creates the jail and uses packages support for jails to install Puppet in the jail, and then that jail signs up as if it was a full machine and checks out its configuration just like it normally would in Puppet and does all the stuff inside. But it's relatively easy to script with either with EasyJail console or just JExec or whatever to run the commands you need to install, or you can just do package minus J, the name of the jail, install foo, and it will install foo in the jail for you as long as the jail's running. So it's quite easy to be able to get it up and running.
Okay. Very nice. Yeah, I'm an IOCage guy. Brandon, I know Brandon pretty well, and he's the author, and I like IOCage, and there's some neat stuff he's doing there that has interest to me for TrueOS and FreeNAS specifically. So I would encourage you to use that, and of course it supports templates. You can fetch and create a FreeBSD default template. One of the features he's looking at adding here in the near future is package-based support. I think he already has some of the bits in for that, which makes the binary updating of the jail a heck of a lot easier. Yes, it's really nice. Like within the jail, you can actually just do package upgrade and done. But anyway,
or even just do all stuff from the host package minus J the jail upgrade and
correct
magic happens.
Yeah, it just magically happens. It's very, very nice. So I would encourage you to take a look at his new rewrite of IOCage, which is adding some of these new features and functionality.
Yes, I'm looking forward to that as well. The main reason I don't use templates or whatever is because I have 100 servers that are all in different data centers, and then they each contain three different jails. Like there's three types of jails and most of them would contain one, two, or three of those. And so it just made more sense to build them up from scratch each time. Over time we've also, we have a diversity of ones running different versions of FreeBSD. I still have a couple I have to upgrade. They're still on 9.3.
Okay. Makes sense. All right, so last up, we have Jungle Boogie writes in. He's written in a few times. He says, hi, all. Linux has something called traffic control that runs in user space and adds latency to TCP connections. He said, what's available in FreeBSD? Is DummyNet the best option? Is there a port with something more updated that you two are familiar with? Now, I've always used DummyNet.
And DummyNet works. Not unmaintained or something. It's very new. It's frequently updated. Actually, I'm proposing a Google Summer
of
Code project to scale it up to support more than 2 gigabits per second of traffic if you actually want to rate limit a 10 gig NIC.
Oh, nice.
Okay. If you're doing ZFS replication across your 10 gig LAN and you would like, ZFS to not take all of it, that's something that'd be interesting.
I wonder, could you just pipe it through something like ZFS send, pipe it to some other user LAN program?
Probably in that one particular case, but... with DummyNet, you can also do queues and stuff. So you can do traffic prioritization. Mm-hmm. So you can say ZFS can have all 10 gigs, but make it back off if there's any other traffic that wants to use the network.
Yeah. Yeah. Other things get priority. Yeah.
So that way, nice. When nothing's happening in the middle of the night, sure, ZFS is going to have all 10 gigs. But, you know, if I start trying to watch a movie or something, back it off and make sure my traffic gets through first, and then ZFS can use up the slack.
Yeah. I've done that on my firewall. It works quite nice. We'd recommend you take a look at that.
It's so I actually wrote an article about this back in May of 2014. So if you check out that edition of the FreeBSD Journal, there's actually an IPFW overview, but it's mostly actually about the cool things you can do with DummyNet. So it shows the basics of doing firewalling with IPFW, which I like very much. But it gets into actually doing the queuing and the piping. And you can do things like you are specifically looking for adding TCP latency. So you can add latency. You can do probabilistic packet loss. You can do artificial queue sizing. So say, you know, after this many packets are waiting to be sent, drop them sooner to reduce buffer bloat. Or you can set it really high to cause buffer bloat if that's what you're trying to test. We've used DummyNet a lot here at work in order to test, you know, how does the video player automatically switch to the lower bit rate, you know, when there's not enough bandwidth and so on. So we actually simulate those conditions by say, all right, create me a pipe that's, you know, this much bandwidth with this much latency and a little bit of packet loss to make sure that it actually works the way it's supposed to.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense.
But yes, DummyNet has been around for a long time, but it's actually actively maintained.
Still and very
it's,
useful.
It was rewritten in 2006, I think, or something. So it's not as old as its history says.
Just because new and shiny doesn't mean it doesn't make something automatically
better,
right? It's actually
technically, I think it's at DummyNet version 3 point something now. So it's been rewritten twice already.
Very cool. Very cool. Yep, we wish you luck with that. Okay, so it's time to close out this episode of BSD Now. So we want to remind you the typical stuff. Send everything to feedback@bsdnow.tv. So I know we're going to be out of town here in a couple of weeks. We got the Storage Summit and then Asia BSD Con and stuff. So keep sending things in.
Yes.
All right. We got stories. We need stories. We need show ideas, topics, questions, comments, you know, you name it. Send it over to feedback@bsdnow.tv so we see it. And we'll look forward to speaking at you again here in the near future.